I've only been here a year at Stony Brook University. It's been a dynamic and exciting year for me. Our celebration today really embodies for me a lot of what our university is about, and the Center for Italian and Italian American Studies embodies a lot of what our university should be about. We're going to be celebrating the center and Mario's work, a center that does great scholarship and really advances new ideas, a center that brings together scholars from all across the university who are interested in Italy and its impacts in the world. And it's a great center that also connects us with the community, which is so vital for us as a university, because we serve you and you enrich us as a campus. So we are very fortunate to have all of you here. Lastly, we are celebrating Mario, who, like many of his generation, are part of that pragmatic and a generation of boundless energy that made this area and that make this university. And we're very fortunate to be able to celebrate through his book, of the immigrant experience, that dynamism that changes America over and over again from generation to generation. So it's really a treat to be able to do so. Our first speaker is going to be Professor Luigi Fontanella. He is a scholar of Italian studies and specializes in Italian immigration. In fact, he's the founder of Italian Poetry in America and the editor of the Gradiva, a prestigious a journal of Italian poetry. He's the president of the International Poetry Prize for Gradiva, and as well is a poet, a critic, a translator, and novelist. He's written and contributed to over 30 books. Luigi, I'm not sure I've read 30 books recently, but okay, that's pretty good.
This will be your homework.
That will be my homework, yeah, good. He's a frequent contributor to America Oggi, an Italian daily published here in the U.S., and actually its September issue featured an article by Luigi on immigration and a review of Mario's book. Welcome, Luigi.
Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone. It's really a nice opportunity and a great honor for me to be here today to present this book and the feelings and the background of this book are very dear to me, and because to some extent I share many of these reflections, many of these moments narrated in the book. The title of the book, as you know, is The Story of My People. And already the title gives us a clue about the content of the book. It is an autobiography. It is Mario Mignone autobiography. And I would say preliminarily that the strong majority of books published, especially in the first early generations of Italian who came to this country, dealt with their own life. And if we give a look as a panorama of the production, the literary production since 100 years ago, we can see that many of them dealt with autobiographical references. Why? Well, it's very easy to explain. The explanation is that when our first immigrants, I'm talking about 100 years ago, even if not more, so 125, 130 years, basically, there was an immediate desire for these people to recognize themselves in another land, but at the same time trying to review their life in relation to a new language, a new culture, a new society, for which they were not prepared, really, both linguistically, first of all, culturally, and their desire was to improve the life of their families. That was the very first desire. But since I'm also a scholar on this topic, on this particular aspect of the literary tradition of Italian Americans in the United States, I would like to underline also a very important aspect which is linked not only to the desire to find a job, to offer a better situation, but I would say also for a desire of adventure, to know another kind of life, another kind of possibilities that are strongly linked not only to the desire to improve the social conditions of their family, but also to face other possibilities and other kinds of life. So the phenomenon of immigration is very complex. It's not linked only to the first necessity. I would like to remind some famous lines by Dante in the Divine Comedy, when he says, with the mouth of Ulysses, fatti non foste a vivere come bruti, ma per seguir virtute e conoscenza. You were born not only to live like brutal animals, but to follow virtue and knowledge. So I think that we should not forget that together with the necessity to change a life and to improve personal conditions of the family, I would say that this is also a conviction that has been proven by many other scholars. I'm thinking about the studies of Franzina, Marazzi, Sebastiano Martelli, Marcello Saia. And it is something that is very evident, for example, in the book by Mario Mignone, especially in the first chapters, in which, of course, there is a necessity to go elsewhere. But, you know, this desire is also connected to open ourselves to other possibilities of life and other possibilities of opportunities. Naturally, one of the risks that especially the first writers, the first authors or intellectuals who came to this country was in a very difficult time, very difficult moments, because they were almost immediately labeled as ethnic writers, which already limits the not only the comprehension, but also the quality and the genuine novelty of this particular literature. And this is evident even with the important writers that we had many, many years ago. I think, for example, John Chardy, for example, a great poet, critic, professor of English. He was one of the first translators, by the way, of the Divine Comedy. Jerry Mangione, Felix Stefanile, and many others. So this first wave suffered very much about this particular diffidence or sometimes discrimination, and sometimes put, these are interesting writers, but you know, let's put them in a kind of ghetto in a way, so that they will not be so relevant. In other words, the only fact that their last name was Italian automatically relegated them in a particular area that somehow was negligible to consider in terms of history of American literature and American culture. Naturally, this situation changes progressively with time, because this next generation, we have people like Joseph Tusiani, Jose Rimanelli, Cecchetti, and so on and so on, who were much more prepared, culturally speaking, linguistically speaking, and in a way, they really represent a evident advancement, an evident progress in terms of recognition, in terms of activity, in terms of professionality, let's say, in a large sense. And in fact, after them, we could say that at the very beginning of the 1960s, the migration almost stopped. We do not have that wave that we had 100 years ago. Although we must say that in the last 10, 15 years, these forms of immigration have returned, even in more dramatic connotations, because unfortunately in Europe, especially in Italy, but also in France and many other countries, Spain, Portugal, Greece, and so on and so forth, we have assisted to a progressive difficulty to find a job, disoccupazione, and so on and so forth. So, in a way, we are facing now, again, a phenomenon that was very evident at the beginning of this flux of immigration. Now, this preliminary observation allow me to introduce myself more in depth with Mario Mignone's book. And it reinforces me the conviction that I said a moment ago about the motivation that are behind and beyond this book. The title of the subtitle of this book is interesting, From Rural Southern Italy to Mainstream America. Why this subtitle? Because Mario is referring especially to a particular phase and particular population, especially in the Mezzogiorno, in the southern part of Italy, who were very much linked to the land, to the conditions of their towns where they were living, where they grew up, and where they had their life. So, in a way, this autobiography wants to underline especially the social and the psychological condition in which his own generation, himself, his family, moved from Italy to America. And especially the first two, three chapters are very dramatic in this autobiography because they really characterized what we could say, using a word of a beautiful book, the concept of spartenza. Spartenza is a beautiful neologism that has been used by a very interesting immigrant, Tommaso Bordonaro, and the book was published by Einaudi in 1991, but I just discovered that has been republished 2 years ago by Navarra Publishers, and has a beautiful introduction by Goffredo Fofi, a very important intellectual who is very much interested in this phenomenon of migration studies and nomadic literature. The word spartenza, of course, implies the word partenza, departure, but spartenza refers also to the fact of disjunction, the parting aspect. In other words, spartenza, spartire, is a verb, doing a little bit the professor of Italian language now, carries on also the verb partire. In fact, è un derivato, it's a derivative of the verb partire, except that partire implicates the sense of going, no? Io parto per l'America. But spartenza indicates the separation of the motherland. So the word spartenza is very rich from a linguistic, lemmatic point of view, because it includes not only the going, but also the separation from your own family, from your land, from your heart, from your blood. And the title of this book, which is a very fortunate book, was written by a person who emigrated to America many years ago, and now has been studied by many, also by scholars, experts in linguistics, because it's very rich of neologism, of words that are a mixture between Italian and English, or adapted to the new language. Mario Mignone arrived to this country in 1960. He is the second brother of eight brothers and sisters. The first brother is Enrico, who was 3 years older than Mario. Mario, Matilde, Maria, Nino, Biagio, Domenico, and Agnese. I mention these names because they are mentioned in the book, and also because they, chronologically speaking, they are brother and sisters of Mario. They are all here in the first picture of the book. And naturally, I cannot not mention the parents, but I put it at the end because they are dulcis in fundo, no? They are the most important persons, Roberto and Palmina. Roberto and Palmina were genitori, the parents of Mario. And the story of his life starts exactly from that photograph. Starts exactly emotionally and mentally from that photograph that Mario describes in these pages when they are all gathered before departing for the United States. And naturally, one of the most important roles of the family was played by the mother. There are beautiful pages on Palmina, and Mario makes a comparison with a famous Latin Roman character, Cornelia. Actually, it's not a character, she was an historical figure. She was the mother of I Gracchi, fratelli Caio e Tiberio Gracco, two important tribuni della plebe, who were very much in favor of democracy, of equal rights, in a period in Rome that was very turbulent and very difficult. And Mario makes this connection recalling an episode of Cornelia when she was at her home and she had some visits of some friends, and they were showing her the jewelry, bracelet, beautiful things. So one of them asks Cornelia, fammi vedere I tuoi gioielli, chi sono I tuoi gioielli, can you show me your jewelry? And she says, yes, certainly. She opens the door and she shows the two kids, Tiberio and Caio Gracco. So this is a reference that Mario makes to give already importance to a very relevant institution which characterize his experience, not only in Italy, but also in America. That is his family. And the mother, Palmina, from what I gather from the book, I never met this woman, but she apparently, to the eyes of Mario, had this particular sensibility, extraordinary, to almost mixture between imagination and intuition, which made her presence very valuable and very crucial in some moments of his life and of the life of his brothers. And I think these are pages very very intelligent, but also very captivating of his autobiography. Of course, there is also the presence of his father, Roberto, who appears in the book a kind of quite silent man, cautious, and somehow perhaps he was the most affectionate to his homeland. And perhaps Mario underlines in his book that he perhaps was the one who suffered mostly the distance from his homeland. Another important character and figure, let's say, not character, figure in this autobiography is his major brother, Enrico, who will become a physician, he will become a doctor. And I met this person because one day, many years ago, I won a special fellowship from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in Italy, And I had to have a visit, a checkup at the consulate in order to, that it was required by the Italian law. And I met Enrico, and I remember him very well, very vividly. He was a very scrupulous man, very attentive.
Probably should say that he was the official.
He was the official doctor of the consulate, that's correct, yes. And therefore, he had the function to visit all the Italian immigrants when they had to either, for example, they were winners of a special fellowship, as it happened to me. And so, in other words, he was a key, a crucial figure to give the okay that you were in sana e robusta costituzione, come si usava dire una volta. No, it was the phraseology used at that time. Enrico, in fact, is not only the first brother who made it in America, he became a doctor, and somehow he also established a kind of a model for his brothers. He was a guide, he was a friend, of course he was his brother, but mainly he was a point of reference for Mario life. And he recalls in his book some episodes of their life, both in Italy and in America. The Gran Potenza was the area where they were living. Gran Potenza is in near Benevento, which is in Campania, but a little bit outside of Benevento. It's a contrada, we would say in Italian language. And they finally arrived in 1960 in America, and their settlement was near Mount Vernon, near Yonkers, which is a city that at the time, but still today, in Westchester, populated the great majority, I would say, still today, by Italian. We are at the very beginning of the 1960s, and Mario, as soon as he arrived, of course, his first necessity was to find a job, any kind of job. So he had this experience in a factory, as many Italians had 50 years ago, 60 years ago, arriving in America. But at the same time, he was also very concerned, not only about, you know, to secure financially his help to his family, but also to have an education. He immediately perceived this conjunction between growth and also the necessity to cultivate his spirit, let's say, and to have a good education. And these years were very active because brought Mario to know America and also to experience a new ways of life, new lifestyles, new habits. And they are described very vividly in these pages, very vivacious pages, because you can feel the eager curiosity of a young man in relation to a new society, a new language, and especially new habits of life. And that's a very interesting, vivacious part that brings Mario to open himself, but also to absorb this new culture in order to be accepted, in order to be part of the mainstream. And in this central part, there are also moments of tragedy. There is the death of in the family of some persons that are very important, starting with Enrico. Starting with Enrico, with a little nephew, Richard, son of Biagio, and of course his mother. And all of these things happened in the beginning of the 1990s. And I found very touching, especially some pages, when one of the brothers, Domenico, who is also a doctor, a physician, really engaged almost in a kind of a titanic, Prometheic battle to not accept that a person so young, so important in their family would disappear. And this part is very moving, I have to say. It touched me very, very strongly, because Domenico wanted to study all possibilities, even audacious, experimental in the field of oncology, in order to see what venues were possible to do to save the life of his brother. Then there is a second part, third part, second and third part, in which we see the education of Mario, first in the high school and the evening schools, and then at the CUNY, City College of New York, and finally, last but not least, at Rutgers University, where he had the first the undergrad and then the graduate education. And these are, of course, years of, also historically speaking, very important. In America, we have the period of the Kennedys. We have Mario is able to combine his personal life with some social events in America that have signed the history of our country. And also, he has some moments of joy of with his friends, with his new. Italian who were doing like him, the same life at CUNY and then later on in at Rutgers University. I found those pages very enjoyable. He does not tell too much about his professors at Rutgers. I don't know why, because Mario, in other occasions, when we were together traveling in Italy with the summer program or the winter program abroad, he told me many stories about his professors, which I thought was beautiful. And in somehow, I hope that he will tell us at least one of the episodes we did. Because these are important professors, you know. I'm mentioning Remigio Ugo Pane. I'm sure that Joe Tursi is here. I'm sure he met. Because to me, when I arrived to America myself, in 1976, Remigio Pane, I found a kind of a father of the Italian. I have to say this, because one day I was at Princeton as a Fulbright, but then I paid a visit to Rutgers because I was looking for a job, naturally. And Remigio Pane was so like a father to me, somehow. He gave me good suggestions. He said, you know, Luigi, it's better if you, because I had my laurea in Rome, my doctorate in Rome was not the PhD yet. So he says, better if you take a PhD, do a PhD. In fact, that's what I did later on. So I was touched by his presence, and I'm sure that Mario or Professor Tursi would say something about him, or Professor Guarino, or I don't know, Mariani, or above all, Glauco Cambon, who has been a great scholar in America, as you know. Glauco Cambon is one of the major scholars in Italianistica in the United States. He was a professor at Rutgers, and later on, I don't know if Mario was still there when he moved to Storrs, to the University of Connecticut, where he established a very important program over there. Anyway, these are years that are very important for the formation, for the cultural formation of Mario, but also for the perspectives that he had ahead. Of course, these are years in which he forms his family, Lois, with three beautiful girls that I have seen many, many occasions. One of them has been also my students, by the way, in Italy, in the summer program. And then, of course, the years here at Stony Brook, which are the most important, I believe, years of Mario for his career. And but Mario is very discreet in this part. He does not want to show up too much. In fact, It doesn't mention some crucial names. I would say, first of all, Professor Tursi, who had was the person who hired Professor Mignone, and unfortunately also myself. Or Senator Lavalle, who's here, who has been a very important
I mentioned him in the introduction.
You mentioned the introduction, okay. But anyway, I'm mentioning these people because, Bill Arends, I think he's here today, and many other professors in this university, or the former president, Ken, Shirley Strom Kenny. Anyway, I'm just mentioning these names briefly because I know how important they have been in Mario's life and also in our life, in my life as an Italianist at Stony Brook University. The book, I would like to end, to conclude with a couple of remarks. At one point of the book, we are going towards the end of the book. The book is very intelligently built because it's a kind of belt. In fact, the buckle of this belt, il fermaglio, is the return. It's a circular book in a way, because at one point Mario recalls that after almost 20 years, he returns to Potenza, to Potenza. And Gran Potenza is the contrada. Anyway, and of course, this is a very important moment. I didn't write this. I wrote an article about this book. I forgot to mention something that if I had to rewrite, I would mention. There is a beautiful poem by Joseph Prusciani titled The Return, which touches a little bit the same thematics of Mario. By the way, this poem, The Return, written in 1952, historically speaking, is very important because it is for the very first time that an Italian in America, Italian-American, won the Greenwood Prize in England, in Great Britain, and that is a very important achievement. Anyway, the return of Mario to his town with Lois, Pamela, Christina, and Elizabeth, it's very important to reflect as a mirror. I use the word reflect precisely as a looking back, but also looking ahead in front of him. And these are really unforgettable pages, very touching, which remind me some beautiful pages by Elio Vittorini and Cesare Pavese, Conversazione in Sicilia, and La Luna e Falò by Pavese. And this part is very important to me because Mario, at this point, is able to combine not only his own story, but also the history of Italians in America. So he tells the story, but within the story expresses many reflections, many important reflections on immigration, on the destiny that each one of us has when has to move from one place to another because of profession, because of job, because of many situations in life. And he does that in a conversation with his old friend. His old friend, his name is Albino, and he recalls not only the past, but at the same time, while he's talking to his friend, he realizes that, you know, time has passed. And now the past is a reflection that cannot change the present. So somehow the past is still alive. It's a beautiful sentence by the famous American writer
Faulkner,
bravo. In which, no, the past is not, the past is still here, the past is dead. It's, I'm recalling by heart that sentence, but it's very important to me, that sentence, because it really reflects the state of mind of Mario in that particular moment. So in other words, we have a text, but also a kind of subtext, kind of meta-text that accompanies the narration at this point of the book. And it is not by chance that now Mario switches from the I who is narrating the story, to we. He uses noi at that point. That's an interesting passage, because the I who is narrating the story becomes a kind of choral voice of people who emigrated with him or like him to another country. And I think this is an important passage that Mario makes around the penultimate and the final chapter, in which he makes reflections. But it's very interesting that he uses noi at that point, not I any longer. And this is perhaps because the motivation for this, and I am concluding, is because the story of my people is the story of our people, in a way. It's not only, he realizes at that point that it's not only my story, this is a story that I'm sharing with you, and I'm sharing with my descendants. It's not a chance that the book, Mario could have, he could buy this book in Italian, but he decided to write in English specifically for this reason, because as we progress, and our kids grow up, and new generations are made, in a way, nephews, nieces, and great-grandchildren, descendants will be able to share this experience, so that this story would become not only a personal story, but an important moment of the history of both Italy and America. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Professor Stanislaus Pugliese, who is a professor of modern European history and the Queensborough Unico Distinguished Professor of Italian and Italian-American Studies at Hofstra University. He serves as the editorial director and fellow of the Hofstra Cultural Center. His research interests cover a wide spectrum of topics related to Italian history, including the study of modern Italy, Italian fascism and anti-fascism, the Holocaust, Italian-American history and culture, and Italian Jews. He studies the intellectual and cultural history of modern Europe and general historiography. He's the author and editor or translator of a dozen books, including one, Bitter Spring, A Life of Ignazio Cicillone, which won the Helen and Howard R. Moraro Prize in Italian History. His latest book is Dancing on a Volcano, A Cultural History of Naples. He's been a frequent participant here at the Center for Italian Studies, conferences, and events, and it's with the pleasure we'd welcome back today to offer remarks on Mario's book, On a Certain Moment in Emigration.
Thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me, Mario. It's a privilege and a pleasure to be back, especially on this occasion. I'd like to begin with two aphorisms. One is from the Italian American Writers Association, and I'm sure several of you here are familiar with it, which is write, W-R-I-T-E, or be written, in the sense that either we write our own history as Italians and Italian Americans, or that history will be written for us by other people, as it has and oftentimes still continues to be written for us today. So Mario's memoir is important in this regard, not just as a kind of personal memoir, but also from the point, as Professor Fontanella said, as a kind of intersection of memoir and social history of a particular moment in time, both for Italy and for the United States. The second aphorism I'd like to that Professor Fontanella mentioned is quote by Faulkner. At one point, these two characters in Faulkner's novel, 1950, Requiem for a Nun, they're sitting at a bar, as many Faulkner personalities are doing. And one is complaining, saying, it's the American South, right? And one is saying, oh man, you're always like obsessed with the past, the past, the past, the past. The past is dead. And the other character says, what do you mean the past is dead? The past is not dead. The past is not even past. In that sense, and I think about this, and I was thinking about this as Professor Fontanella was speaking, as I reread the memoir last night, and I was thinking about how in the course of simply one or two generations, our lives have changed so radically. So I would like to begin with a couple of personal anecdotes. And I address this question to the young people, the students in the room. This is the question that I begin every time I teach my course on Italian American history. I say, I'm going to recount to you a scenario, a historical scene, and you're going to tell me what century this takes place in. So there are two landless peasants that decide, they fall in love and they decide to get married. I apologize to some of my colleagues who have heard this before. Two landless peasants, they decide to get married. They then proceed to have five daughters, which is an economic catastrophe. Why? Because in this place and this time, to marry a daughter, what did you need? You needed a cow, a house, obligata, an olive grove, a flock of sheep. If you were the son, the prospective groom, you know, you needed something similar. And the two fathers would sit down at the bar over a glass of wine and say, okay, I give you the lubata, the olive grove, and a flock of 50 sheep. And I say, my daughter will bring the house and the linens. You shake hands over a glass of wine, and next week they get married. But if you don't have an olive grove, if you don't have a wheat field, if you don't have vineyards, if you don't have a flock of sheep, what do you do? Well, you go knock on the door of the local aristocratic family, and you say, please, please, can I look after your sheep? Well, yes, you can look after my sheep, but at the end of the month, you have to bring certain kilos of cheese to my door. Please, please, can I harvest the olives? Yes, you can harvest the olives, but when you finish the harvest, you have to bring certain kilos of olive oil to the kitchen. But what if there's none left over? Well, then there's none left over, that kind of thing. And so I asked the young people in the room, what century am I talking about? Most of my students say, oh, Professor, you're talking about the Dark Ages. Yeah. Professor, you're talking about the Middle Ages. Professor, you're talking about 500 years ago. And I say to them, I'm talking about the Mezzogiorno, Southern Italy, in 1952. And one of those five daughters was my mother, who left school, was pulled out of school in the third grade to go watch the sheep in the fields. 70 years later, my mother still has nightmares of the snakes falling on her head when they were harvesting the olives in the autumn. We'll get back to the snakes because Mario has a problem with snakes. My father, on the other hand, was born in the north, in Montefalcone, provincia di Avellino. That's a joke from Genova, outside of Milan. And his family actually had some land, and he was educated to the fifth grade, but was a musician, and for 10 years lived in Rome and played with the famous Bersaglieri band. I don't know if you know them. They're the ones that run and play in the Columbus Day Parade. In 1962, my father, on the telephone call or a letter of my uncle who was here, Master Taylor, came to visit him. He met my mother, set up by my uncle. 2 months later, they were married. My father never went back. He left a life in Italy, and he created a life here. I recount these stories to you because as I was reading Mario's memoir, although we are from two different generations, I felt legato, what's the word?
Bound.
Tied, bound to this story. In a way that was actually quite poignant for me, very, very poetic. I was struck by, in this book, by the fact that there is no kind of hagiography, there is no golden nostalgia. Everything from the initial departure in 1960 to this critical chapter of going back almost 20 years later, which I'll also talk about, is really complex, nuanced. It's a very profound meditation on leaving, arriving, attempting to return, and discovering the reality that it's not possible to return. From the very first chapter, Mario talks about this, the family had actually decided to take the opportunity of being in Rome to see the cultural and touristic sites. And the famous photograph that was taken at that moment, which he writes, it was a photograph that had the air of a funeral and this kind of drama and even trauma of emigration, as he calls it, equivalent to death. It was a very strong consciousness that it was most likely that he would not see many of the people who had accompanied them to Rome to see them off, including his paternal grandmother. Which then raises the question, to what extent can we or should we see emigration as a betrayal of the patria? Now, 1960 was a special moment in immigration history, as I said, both for Italy and for the United States. In Italy, the best and the brightest were leaving. That's not to imply that in the great wave of immigration at the end of the 19th century, the beginning of the 20th century, those were not Italy's most valuable people. In fact, I think that all of those millions of landless peasants that left the Mezzogiorno represented a cultural patrimony that had been lost to the new nation. And in fact, we have to ask the question, what does it mean that within one generation of creating a new country, that as soon as the means were available, the steamship, the telegraph, the patronage system, millions and millions of Italians decided to leave? What? And in fact, I'm not sure the statistic, maybe someone can, there are just as many Italians outside of Italy as inside of it, no? Right? So think of what...
There's more.
More. So imagine what Italy would be today in the 21st century if those people had not left. It's just extraordinary to think about. And why is it that, as Mario writes in the first couple of chapters of the memoir, he had never even heard of this story in school? Why was it that in the national schools of Italy, the story of emigration, which you cannot understand Italy without the chapter on emigration, it's not even a chapter, it's sort of like a un filo rosso, like a thread that goes through all of, because yes, after 1924 and the Second World War, yes, immigration was less, but it was a different kind of immigration. Just as today, Italy too has people that are coming here and also people who are entering. Mario likens this moment of emigration to both the traumatic cutting of the umbilical cord, and yet there was also a sense of adventure that accompanied all the family and other immigrants as well. He's very sensitive to the psychology of the immigrant, which requires not just courage and ambition, but also a kind of what he called an innate Ulysses-like desire for discovery. I've oftentimes thought about this. When I see my own family, my father, my mother, my relatives, people like Mario, I'm trying to work out this theory that the Italians who left were sort of like the Italian Calvinists. Not that they, not theologically, but in the sense of that idea of work and family and all of that, that there was the recognition that there is no place for us here in this new country, even 100 years, 1960 afterwards. But in leaving, in this kind of betrayal of the patria, there is a personal price to be paid. For as Mario himself admits, the immigration, the mission, and its determination to succeed hinders some of us from oftentimes some of our more personal roles, as he admits himself that he could have been a better father. But he, like my father, maybe like myself, even though I was born here, oftentimes caught up in the possibilities that are in front of us, we sometimes neglect some of the things that we should have done. What does it mean? What did it mean in the post-war period that millions of southern Italians, left these villages either to go, let's say, to Milan or Torino to work in the Fiat factories or Switzerland or Belgium or Australia or the United States? And then there was the question also, why leave Italy in the middle of what was called il boom, the economic boom, the beginning of La Dolce Vita? It's no coincidence, Mario leaves in 1960, the year Fellini's La Dolce Vita comes out. I find that kind of interesting. And also interesting is Mario's view of America before arriving and right at the moment of arrival. There's no kind of shiny-eyed mythology or this idea that the streets are going to be paved with gold. And to read those first few pages are very interesting because he himself interrogates himself. He chastises himself. He comes the first day, he's picked up, he and his family, by his relatives, two big station wagons. They cross the Whitestone Bridge, you know, very impressive. Although Manhattan looks like, you know, those buildings look very small, his brother says, and the other brother says, because we're far away, right? There's this kind of, almost a kind of spatial incongruence, you know, to come from, let's say, a place like Gran Potenza, Contrada of Benevento, and then to be thrown into the maelstrom of New York City in 1960. Some of you know Robert Viscusi's memoir, Astoria, which is a play on words, which is because he grew up in Astoria, Queens, but the title also means, Astoria is the Italian word for both story and for history, which is a kind of innate human need that we all have, right, to tell our story, otherwise other people will tell the story for us. And Bob Viscusi has this great line in the story which said that millions of Italians, they left the Middle Ages, they slept in the ocean, and they woke up in the 20th century in New York City. I oftentimes think when I go back to my mother's town, or my father's town, and my wife and I try to bring our children there every year to show them, you know, how we have gone from this kind of life, which was not much removed from the Middle Ages, to, you know, iPhones, iPads, Snapchat, and whatever in the space of two generations. It's an extraordinary cultural, and I don't think it's ever happened in the history of humanity, this kind of, not just for us Italians, but for other people as well, to make this kind of cultural shift. And the fact that millions and millions of them did it successfully is absolutely extraordinary. It's not possible that psychologists, social psychologists, have not examined this phenomenon of what is it in peasant culture that allows, let's say, people who were living in these kinds of conditions in the 1920s, in the 1940s, in the 1960s to pick up and become successful in the most cosmopolitan, sophisticated, technologically advanced society in the world. You have to read Mario's comparison on the first day in America between Italian gelato and American ice cream. it's really extraordinary. And this kind of cultural tension between Italian and American culture. The comments on American Wonder Bread are absolutely extraordinary. And I tell you this story because when my wife was going to elementary school, my wife came to America when she was 3 years old. And of course, her mother used to make these Italian sandwiches. And her best friend, who was Italian-American, already like second or third generation, would go to school with peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. My wife was obsessed with peanut butter and jelly sandwiches because it meant America to her. So every day they would switch sandwiches without telling the mothers because they felt it was a kind of cultural betrayal. The fact that I was eating my friend's peanut butter and jelly sandwich and she was taking my, you know, melanzane. So another interesting thing, Mario points out that how his paternal grandfather came to America in 1906 while, you know, he and his mother and siblings, his father came over later, left in 1960. In 1960, the Olympics had just finished in Rome. Yes. Fellini was creating this mythology of the Via Veneto and La Dolce Vita. John F. Kennedy was elected president just a few months after they arrived. He talks about the youth culture that was forming in kind of response to the conformity of the 1950s. But what I found very important and striking was the sense that Mario understood at the time, fostered by both John F. Kennedy and Lyndon Johnson, that, quote, men and women from all backgrounds have common beliefs and aspirations, common rights, common responsibilities in relationship with each other. This is a sense I would suggest that has been lost to a certain extent in our country, unfortunately. His first job in the factory impressed on him both the paternal benevolence of the owner of the factory, who's not Italian, but it also raised important questions in his mind when he saw a factory worker being summarily fired. So both sides of the equation. So some extraordinary passages about Thanksgiving. As I'm sure many of us have this kind of cosmopolitan, dual, almost a kind of schizophrenic holiday where, yes, we have the turkey and the pumpkin pie and the cranberries, but always preceded by lasagna, and, you know, which are obligatory. But more profound was his father's annual benedictions at the Thanksgiving table. His father, who had difficulties acculturating to American society, both because of the work and the social relations, has these extraordinary blessings at the Thanksgiving table, which are a combination of both the religious and the secular. But Mario himself confesses that it took him, he was 20 when he arrived, so he confesses that, honestly, that it took him some time to leave that older mentality behind. He tells this very poignant story of finding a younger brother playing with a tricycle in the apartment building. And he chastises his brother because the mentality that they came from was that if you have any spare time, you spent it working on the farm, taking care of the animals, things like that. There was no concept of leisure or having toys and playing, things like that. But to his credit, he understood that this was a kind of different culture. An extraordinary metaphor about immigrant life. And this is for people who understand soccer. Italian soccer was famous in the 1950s and 60s for the style of play called catenaccio, the big chain, you know, the defensive lockdown, you know, trying to win a game 1-0. And yet Mario was perceptive enough to say, you cannot live in America with that kind of mentality. You have to be able to go out there, seize the day, make things happen. Don't be passive, okay? And like Professor Fontanelle mentioned, there are passages here about Mario's time both at City College and Rutgers which are absolutely extraordinary. And I'm glad to say that, you know, he mentions, you know, even people that I know like Vito De Simone and Giuseppe Battista, who's here today, both dear friends. And although I am of a different generation, my experience was very similar, because if it was not for Hofstra University, and if it was not for the CUNY graduate school, I would not be a professor. And I don't know if you know this, but when the CUNY graduate school was created in 1960-something, there was a big debate, because the argument was that City University had a mandate for undergraduate education, to educate the first generation oftentimes of immigrants. And yet the idea of, you know, making a PhD possible to a son of immigrants was an extraordinary idea. And the fact that, you know, a son of landless peasants could become a professor in America is absolutely extraordinary. It would never have happened in Italy. And for Mario, this was an experience that convinced him that, and this is how the chapter on City College and Brooklyn closes, quote, "America was made for us and we were made for America." I'm going to skip a couple of these things because in the interest of time, other speakers, Mario has to speak. But here is what I find very interesting. The possibility of combining the past peasant culture with modernity. His mother, who used to say to him, "Chi va con lo zoppo incomincia a zoppicare." He who goes around with people who limp eventually begin to limp. Or as my mother and father used to say, meglio solo che male accompagnato. Better to be alone than in bad company. And yet, this was a culture which produced, quote, three doctors, a dentist, two university professors with PhDs, and two teachers, as his mother liked to point out. For me, the most poignant chapter of all was chapter 14, which Professor Fontanella pointed out, the return. When Mario goes back to Gran Potenza in 1978, husband, father of three young girls, and this chapter really has some passages which reminded me of Proust, Alla ricerca di tempo perduto, but this is not nostalgia. Nostalgia from the Greek, which means a painful desire to return home. This is something else, a returning home and then a feeling of pain. Because there is no possibility of return. The great birch tree that had sheltered the family home which had provided shade on the fiercely hot days, which had embraced the family during meals and naps in the fiercely hot afternoons, had been cut down. And certain passages reminded me of Pavese. I'm glad to see I'm in such distinguished critical company. Passages of Pavese writing about his beloved hills of Piemonte, the Langhe, and the character Anguilla in La Luna e Falò, Anguilla, the eel. The eel is the animal that, like the salmon, returns to its birthplace to reproduce. Or the image of the eel or the snake, the Ouroboros. The Ouroboros is the snake with the tail in its mouth, representing in ancient mythology the eternal desire to return. Mario confesses here in this chapter to a lifelong fear of snakes. But in that return home, as he is visiting the family ancestral home, he finds an old bale of hay, sits down as the sun is setting, and falls asleep for a few minutes, and has this nightmare of being bitten by a snake. No Freudian analysis, I promise you. what I really want to do, because I was rereading this passage last night, I want to just read one paragraph to you to give you a sense of the beautiful language. And as you will hear Pavese, you will hear Ciloni, Vittorini, and these other great Italian writers. When I arrived at the Gran Potenza, it was late afternoon, and life was returning to the fields after the siesta. I don't know why, but I wanted to calmly see the farmhouse and the land that held so much of my early experience in life. There was nothing in particular that I wanted to check, but I had a burning desire to see again the places where my mind, where my family and I had lived and struggled, and that I had left without much pain or remorse. I had traveled the world. I had read a lot. I had become a university professor. What could I find back in that house, in that piece of land besides, where to say, here is where I was when I was born? Probably we need a village, a place, if nothing else, for the pleasure of saying, here are the seeds of my life. Your village means that you're not alone, that you know there's something of you in the people, in the plants, in the stones, the soil. So that even when you are not there, there is something that waits to welcome you. There may be a subconscious desire that makes us look for that somewhere, that makes you say, here is what I was, and this is what I am. A somewhere that makes you believe that it belongs to you, that somewhere which you try to grasp the essence of your origin and therefore of your identity. I had been around the world enough to know that all human flesh is basically the same, that anyone is worth as much as anyone. And it's probably because of this that one gets tired and tries to find his roots, so that his flesh is worth a little more and lasts a little longer than a round of seasons. It's an extraordinary passage. And just one more from the same chapter, and then I'll conclude. Albino, the friend that Professor Fontanella mentioned, reminded me we were better off than they were, these other families, because his sisters had to carry the water on their heads. We got closer to the house. The cowshed was lifeless without the smell of fresh manure. No part of the roof had collapsed, but everything conveyed a sense of abandonment. Nothing was there anymore. Nothing was the same. Step after step, I was struck with a feeling of absence. What was no longer had become something else. I doubt that even if someone had kept the cow, the sheep, and the pig, and the other animals we had, that I would not have been able to sense the old environment with the sensitivity of my childhood. I was now an adult who lived in the city. I had worked in factories, was enjoying the comfort of office work. In the process, we acquire, but we also lose. What was no longer is, and what is left only exists in memory. Really extraordinary. Paradoxically, he writes at the end in the last chapter, we had become poorer to become richer. To become an immigrant is almost by definition to be insecure. Being simultaneously insecure and desiring to make it creates a potent, and I would add, a very fertile tension in one's life. The last page, Mario concludes by quoting Pico della Mirandola's Oration on the Dignity of Man. And although the Renaissance humanist could not have known it, his manifesto that men and women have the ability to rise to the level of angels or descend to the level of brutes is also the manifesto of the immigrant. And we owe Mario Mignone a debt for reminding us of this beautiful idea. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our last speaker is the Honorable Ken LaValle, State Senator Ken LaValle, since his election to the New York State Legislature in 1976 and his appointment as the Chairman of the Senate Committee on Higher Education in 1979, has helped shape higher education policy in New York State. His work with education leaders at the State University of New York, the City University of New York, and independent colleges has earned him the respect of the academic community. In 2007, the governor appointed Senator LaValle to the New York State Commission on Higher Education. Senator LaValle also serves on the National Council of State Legislatures Blue Ribbon Commission on Higher Education, whose goal was to create awareness among state legislatures of their role in providing accessible and affordable public higher education. He was presented the Medallion of the University from the State University of New York at Albany and the University Medal from Stony Brook University, the highest honors accorded by both universities. All these responsibilities and achievements have encouraged and energized work and active partnership with the State University of New York at Stony Brook, and as a means of expressing their appreciation in part for the assistance he's provided us, we named our campus stadium in 2002 in his honor. Extremely proud of his Italian heritage, it was natural to enlist Senator LaValle in support of Mario Mignone's initiative in 1985 to create a Center for Italian Studies here at the university that would uniquely serve as a bridge between the campus and the community. He has served as honorary chairman of the center's advisory board throughout the center's 35 years and generously participates in as many of the programs as his commitments allow, and it's a pleasure to have him here today. Along with this opportunity to remark on Mario's authorship of The Story of My People, he especially wants to be present here today to share his sentiments about his association he's had with the center. Welcome, Senator.
You notice I don't have any cards, and I don't have any notes, and I haven't opened my water. So I hope to encapsulate what is important. Our relationship is one of almost 40 years. And so I have, over this period of time, gotten to know Mario's family, siblings, children, grandchildren. Now, when you think of this book, it starts with Greatest Generation, then Mario and the siblings, the Silent Generation, the children, Boomers and X Generation, and then the grandchildren, Millennials and Z Generation. And what really fascinated me was that you start from A to Z, and you see a potential template for the kinds of things that you want to see a family have, that his family has achieved. So one day I said to Mario, and he acknowledged it in the introduction, why don't you write a book? You heard how many MDs, DDS. Nino's the one person I know the least, the dentist, and PhDs. So through the book you see, and the family, you see intellectual brilliance, and it goes from one generation to the other. So some of it, Mario, is genetic, and some of it is putting people on a pathway to to achieve the kinds of things that they need to do. You see great energy. That's very important in a family structure. Knowing the family, there is the moral and religious compass that is requisite within the family. So when I think of, and I say to you, it's a good template when you read and you say, wow, it is also coming from an Italian family. It is very helpful to understand some of the things that happen. I'm sure it's different for other ethnic groups, but there is enough to say this is the template that you want to follow. There is a commitment to giving back, being part of the community, and you could go on and on. I also give him great credit. It's not something I would do, to reflect on your siblings and to define them through your eyes. That's gutsy. God bless you. So I think you did a marvelous job, and having the experience of living in Italy, crossing the ocean, coming here, discussion of the plane trip and the apprehensions, to the uncle picking you up at the airport. That's pretty frightening. And yet, you can see from almost day one, I've got to work, got to provide, and just keep full speed ahead through your working in the factory, to your education, and then what you have done as a professor, the acknowledgments and the writings, that books that you have done, you have used your skill and understanding modern Italy to being an Italian American in this country, and it all gets bridged together. So you've done really a very marvelous job. I have to repeat again, this is a wonderful template for other people to say, let's look at it, because family is everything. Everyone knows that. It's very important. So where you can get some help in understanding what has succeeded, and if you're Italian American, this is a book that is a must read. You did an incredible job.
I cannot hide the fact that I'm a bit moved. I've been doing this for many, many years. The senator knows this, but I'd like to remind the dean that this is my 46th year here at Stony Brook. I came here in 1970. So I've been standing in front of public many, many times, giving lectures in conference. But this is different, following what these three friends close friends, dear friends, have said about me, my family, and what we have, in a way, achieved, but which is not unique, really. But the fact that we were eight and no one went off tracks, I think it's should be mentioned that. Let me just begin by saying that thank you. Thank you to all of you for coming. Thank you to the my dear friends of you, all of you. I was afraid that Professor Pugliese was not going to be here, but I really appreciate making these extra efforts. If I can say this, I don't know, his daughter's in hospital. But wish you the best.
My pleasure.
My prayers, really. And we hope that everything will be okay. But thank you. Thank you for coming, certainly. Thanks to my siblings for being here. Some of them. Yeah. Nice. My friends from, a couple of friends from City College. There is also one of my cousins of here who graduated from Stony Brook, did medical school at Stony Brook, is a surgeon now, but I was surprised that he came all over from New Jersey here in Tanya. So you come back to your alma mater. Very good. Now, you know what? Wonderful things have been said. It's the first time that I've been doing all this my life to take a text and to analyze a text. And now I'm seeing things there that people are not analyzing my own writings. So it's different, really. And you say there, you sit there, yeah? Is that true? I cannot hide the fact that I could not write this type of autobiography if I had not done some readings, including, yes, Pavese, and including, yes, I Malavoglia, Pavese, Virga, yes, there's no question. But I could not have written this. The experience of an immigrant is not enough. I have been teaching migration for many years, so I have that kind of scholarly preparation. But I have never done with this kind of creative writing. When the Library of Congress invited me to work on that book on Began Presence in America, I was told not to be dry, not to be scientific, because this was going to be a book that was going to be end up on the coffee table of the people. So light writing. So, and I tried. And I must say that I enjoyed it. So I said, let me do something else. And here I am. So it is an autobiography, there's no question. And why do we write these autobiographies? It's because of narcissism, vanity. Because we have really something interesting to share, a lesson that you've learned and they would like to share with other people, probably communicate certain values that you believe in, like family. It may be also a form of therapy, you know, to voice out fears, insecurity, to unload burden that we have been carrying for a long time. The act of writing is always an act of public confession, no question. Because, yes, even those things that are scientific, but it's a reflection, it's become part of you, and then you share with people. So, but writing an autobiography, it's also it's to reflect on your past. We step out of ourselves and look our past from a distance. So we are at the same time subjects and objects. Yes, when I went to Italy and I was looking at myself, at my past. think if I was, and we met, and we clashed in a sense. Because really when you emigrate, you are reborn again, okay? Born a second time. And I was born again at the age of 20. And when I went back to 18 years later, certainly it was a clash. I was a sad return. Why? Because I had changed, and life up there had changed too. But we have not changed the same way. And so you can, it's like being born. You cannot return in the womb of your mother. It's a strange feeling, but also, as I said, a terrible feeling. When you write this kind of book, you try to be candid, but you depend from the memory. Memory plays a very important role, certainly. We don't remember everything that happened in our lives. Certainly, if any one of my brothers and sisters would have written our story, would have been a different story, because of our memory works in different ways, certainly. But when we tell the story, or this kind of story, certainly it's not just what memory gives you, and memory can play tricks. There are certain things that are given back to you, and other things that are not for certain reasons. We try probably to suppress them. Memory is a tremendous gift, but also it could be also a curse, because there are a lot of things probably that we wish that do not remember. Mm-hmm. And so there is the unconscious, certainly, but there is also the conscious. How much of what I remember, I'll put in. So that process of selection, discrimination, yes, this is how these things fit in telling a story. And so it was not easy. Some people said, well, but you had the courage. Mario, you really had the courage to say certain things. As we before we were talking about the World War II, immediately after the war, and the kind of poverty that exists in those years. And so when I talk about the life back in my farm, the kind of life that we had, and the things that within that, it was not just us. But that was the world then, immediately after war. The suffering was not just the Mignones on Gran Potenza, but it was really widespread. So when I tried to write this story, yes, I wrote this, it's my story, it's a story of my family, but it's a story of my people, really. It includes so many people that I met at the factory. He mentioned before that the reason why I care about the labor unions, because when we had a tremendous boss, Mr. Hertelein, Carl Hertelein, I still remember him, tremendous man. He knew that I had at home a big family, and so he was very appreciative, and he supported me, allowed me to go to school at night. I left the machine over the idle sometimes, not producing anything. But I was, even though it was a nice person, and good environment, I was shocked when I saw that the foreman went to this man and said, collect your tools. It was 9:30 in the morning. collect your tools, and you must leave with a check in his hand. I know what the guy deserved to be fired, I should say, because I was better, you know, upset the way he was behaving in a shop, taking newspaper, going to the bathroom, and spending half an hour over there, practically on, I mean, every day. So that was, in a way, was bothering me. But it bothered me also the way he was fired. And the foreman, they moved, and they collect all his tools, and he was escorted to the door. And so I start to wonder what this man, when he went home, and he had to talk to his wife, and to talk to his children. And so that scene for me got ingrained in my sight. And so I said, we need some kind of protection. And so, yes, I sent the book, we need the labor unions. So, yeah. Now, as I said, I selected those items of my life and our lives that I, to tell a story. But a story that is not just mine, ours, or the story of my friend Joe Baptiste, immigrant, but a story of the immigrant. My story. Story of your of yourself, probably, your parents, your grandparents, or great grandparents, if you know. Because it's the events that I touch are pleasant in such a way that I take all my knowledge of the immigration, the study of immigration. And that were in the story to craft in a way that is not just a story of the story of the Mignone, but the story of the immigration, with which many of you, in fact, one student said he read the book. I don't know, that only very few students of here in my class. He read the book, says, Professor, could I would like to write the optional paper on the book. Could I relate it to the story of my parents from Korea? I said, you got it. That was my intent, to see how much these, my story and the story of your parents coincide, even though that we come from different parts of the world. And when in the book there are all the elements, the topos of immigration. That is the uprooting, and certainly uprooting, because Rotella can, he's also went through this, is not the same for everybody. The uprooting, when you take a plant, if it's a young plant, it's easier to pull, right? And so for my sister was 4 years old, that uprooting was easier. For my sister, for me, it was harder, 2018. And so was also the transplanting that followed. Certainly transplanting for my sister, 4 years old. But for us, and you can imagine for my father, who came over here when he was 56. Very difficult. My father was tragic, really. Before Professor Donato was talking about that important book, Spartenza, because when you emigrate, there is partire, it's to divide, and yes, you take one part with you, and you leave the other, some other, over there, certainly. I use various, certainly, metaphors in the book. When I talk about the family and how we made it, really. I don't like to brag about this, but after 3 years we were in the United States, we bought a five-family building, okay? And it's not that we were making millions working. I was making, I think, $1.15 an hour. But it's the family was working like the metaphor of a beehive. Each one of my siblings was delivering newspaper, was working in a supermarket. And so at the end of the day, my mother was the queen in this BI. And so it's, this was, yes, was the way that we managed. It was a rock-like family. See, we cared, you know, about the welfare of the family collectively, but also we didn't give up the individual ambitions, okay? And it, for us, it worked very well, I think. So now my Luigi, you know, brought up the issue of my mother and Cornelia, Roman figure of the. Well, the fact is that my mother had only a third grade education. But she cared very much, certainly, about the education of the children. And so, I said this in the book, every time that we got a degree, we give to her. And she, instead of having paintings in her living room, she had our various degrees, okay? And so, yes, there were, at the end, there were three medical degrees, a dentist degree, and I used to tell my mother, I said, Mommy, you never didn't have a chance, but these are your trophies, the result of your victories. And she used to really cherish these things. I must say that it's because of the question about my father, but certainly my mother played an extremely important role in our lives, as did most of the mothers. We're strong women, sometimes joking, but it's always in the joke there is some kind of reality. I don't know, my father managed with my mother. And all the women in my family, very strong, extremely strong. But typical of Southern Italian women, okay? Only when I studied immigration, I could understand why they were so strong. We used to call my grandmother the general. But, you know, my grandfather came over here in 1907, and he took part of some of the children were not married in 1947, okay? So my grandmother spent a good part of her life without the presence of the husband. My grandfather went back and forth, back and forth. She would get pregnant. And so my mother and my grandma said, my God. But then, you know, it's, she had to be wife and the husband, mother and father, had all those roles that she had to play. And my mother grew up without practically a father. And so, you know, you understand it. So it's, you develop this strong character. But I must say, Dinka, that I had a little bit of resentment to when I was younger, towards my grandmother, for being so rough. And then, you know, certainly I understood, and now, you know, God bless her. You know, the most difficult part of the book is certainly, as I said, as Rich said, also Stan said, it's when I go back. Yes, those are beautiful pages, I think. I felt those pages. I must say that I went there to take my children, to see where I came from, my roots. You know, I want to tell them, you know, wherever you go on this land, you know, it's a step, every stone. But I was very disappointed. They were too young. They didn't care. So what I did, I took my wife back to the village over there. We had a lunch, and they went to take a nap. I got back in the car, and I went to Grandpa's house because I needed to see that. I need to smell the heaven, I mean, everything. And so, yes, with my old friend of childhood, Albino, we recounted a little bit of the past together. And you go through and they say, you know, a lot of people have passed away and that's all life. So there was, yes, I think they're very touching pages. I was moved, certainly, and I was moved when I was writing them. And I was moved when you were reading them. Because when I was writing them and then I was reading them in my mind, you know? I could hear the story. But it's the life of on a farm. It's yes. Solitude in a way, because you know, you grow up without having too many friends around. But we also develop a certain character, certainly working on a farm. And my experience in the factories prepared me in a certain way that sometimes didn't come. When some of my colleagues complain about too much work, I resent that. It bothered me because I said I came from college, graduate school, director, and so I can certain times I cannot tolerate certain components. But it's a book that yes, it tells a story of the immigration, not of what happens later on as a professor. So that's why I don't mention Stony Brook, I don't mention the graduate school, because when I went to graduate school, unfortunately I had a federal scholarship. And so I was saying, God bless America. I could not believe it, that I was being paid to study. It was not part of our culture. And so if they went by and I had not been studying, I swear to God, I felt guilty because I had been used to work intensely. And so, but that is not a part of the story of migration, so that's why I stopped in that moment. But if you just push me, we'll do a second part.
I think you should.
But let me, it's a book that I, oh gosh, there was a lot of thinking, okay? Yes, it was spontaneous, but not so spontaneous. The most difficult part is, I think, it's always how to start the book. Because you have to catch, you know, the interest of the reader. Luigi he quoted Dante the Ulysses, chapter, you know, canto 26. It starts as, considerate la vostra semenza. Consider your origin. You were not made like groups, but to find virtue and knowledge. But it's what that certain passage is always in our minds. But at this point, what I would like to recall is the first verse of the Divine Comedy. And Dante says, nel mezzo del cammin di nostra vita, in the middle of words about lives, of our lives, even though we know that Dante takes a trip on his own. But in that first verse, he's not saying, nel mezzo del cammin della mia vita, of my life. He says, of our lives. And so he will sketch the reader. It's my story, but it's also your story. And so I start the book over here with this, that find a strategy, okay? We all, I don't say I, we all feel inspired to display our favorite photographs about the house or collect them in an album in an attempt to capture what we consider the most important moments of our lives, and they give them some sense of order and narrative coherence. They remind us of who we are, where we come from, and what is dear to us. They usually do. And so, we keep them in the most prominent place in our living room and where we work. We even carry them with us wherever we go, for example, in our wallet with our money. I remember when I was a child, my paternal grandmother carried close to her heart the picture of her son who had emigrated to America many years before and that never come back. And so, with this strategy about the picture, everybody has a picture, I hope that I started to get the attention and the participation in the story of the reader. And I go on naturally with my story. So, the book, yes, as all three of them have indicated very well, I said, better than I'm able to do. It's the story of the Mignone's family, but it's the story of any immigrant. You'll find, as I said, your story or the story of your parents, great grandparents, or talking to my few students over there. Wherever you come from, China, India, Pakistan, yes, there is. You can identify with the story because all the elements, the topos of immigration, are here. Again, we have a few copies of the book. Afterwards, we can move to the next room, and there are some refreshments. But most of all, thank you for coming.